let's start. Our science and society speaker today is Michael Eisen from the University of California, Berkeley. Actually, this is not the first science and society seminar that Michael gives at EMBL. We invited Michael 2 years ago to give a seminar down in Monte Rotondo. And it so happened that this was at the time of the World Cup. It was the European Champions. This was the European Championships, and it was on a Friday. And it so happened that this was on a day when Iceland was playing England. And Iceland miraculously won against England. You know, we all know how difficult it is to work out sometimes causalities. And I don't know to what extent Michael was in any way responsible for the outcome. But however, now for the second invitation to give a science and society seminar at EMBL, it so happens that this is at the time of the World Cup, and today is also a Friday, and today Iceland is playing Nigeria. We'll see how that turns out. But in any case, if Iceland wins, I will do everything that I can, possibly, to see to it that Michael gets invited again in 2020, and hopefully on a Friday as well. Now, Michael is giving a seminar today under the title "Slow, Closed, Expensive, and Ineffective: How Science Publishing is Killing Science and How to Fix It." And we have asked Maria Leptin to introduce our speaker and chair this session. Of course, most of you, if not all of you, know that Maria is a EMBL group leader in the Developmental Biology Unit and also a director of EMBL. And evidently, EMBL has enormous vested interest in all questions relating to scientific publishing. So I hand you over to Maria.
Mike is a force of nature, as you will see, and it's a great pleasure to have him here. It's a great pleasure to have known him for a long time, and let me just quickly give you an overview of his CV, which illustrates the force of nature, and for nature, actually. So he's always had great interest. against nature with a capital N. That's a different one, yes. Mike got his PhD. Mike has a big interest in maths, which actually also pervades the work he's doing. But he started out as a good proper biologist, doing his PhD at Harvard with Don Wiley on influenza proteins. He then went to Stanford, where he worked initially with Dave Botstein on yeast and gene expression. And he was there at a time when microarrays became invented. I used to teach them at university, and they've completely gone. But it was a time when big data began, big data collections, and means of handling them and means of interpreting them. So it was a really exciting time. So he worked on gene expression using microarrays, and then he also began to work on Drosophila, on gene expression. Great, I'll recognize them. Continue to work on Drosophila, on genes, on chromatin, on genome arrangement, and on genome comparisons through that on evolutionary questions. I mean, his curiosity knows no limits, and his ability to absorb information also not. So all the while, his science, you know, he was a force to reckon with in science, but he did things on the side. So one big thing he did on the side, of course, was to be an advocate for open access. And he, together with his brother Jonathan and Pat Brown and Harold Varmus, etc., started the move for open access in a big way, and they were the founders of PLOS Biology, and we know we all know PLOS biology and all the consequences that came from it. As if that was not enough, also he's a massive blogger and Facebooker. We read about his children and all their travails on Facebook. He blogs endlessly. He writes to the president. And as you may know, he's running for Senate for California in 2018. Having second thoughts? Yeah.
No, not okay. Second thoughts. Okay.
Anyway, so I mean, one could go on endlessly about Mike, but it's much more fun to go on endlessly with Mike. And in fact, the with is very important because Mike would like to relive his youth as a grad student at Harvard, where in seminars, the front row of professors and PIs would grill you 2 minutes into your talk or 2 seconds into your talk. So he really doesn't want this to be a lecturing and hectoring event, but he wants you to ask questions right away. So rather than saying he's going to talk for 45 minutes and then we'll have 45 minutes discussion, please interrupt. Please ask questions. Challenge him as we go along, and it'll be more. Exactly. Guys, you as EMBL scientists, and I see a whole bunch of editors and writers and administrators here, you guys have a reputation to live up to as a critical audience.
And please, if you ask questions or make comments, please make use of the microphones because this is being recorded and transmitted. Yeah.
Okay, so shout if you have a question. I'm going to sit with my back to you, but I'll try and pay attention to you.
Thank you for having me. This is really an honor. Actually, my first time I was ever at EMBL was to teach a class on microarrays back in the good old days. So there's a lot of like antiquated technology theme in some of the things I'm going to talk about. So microarrays are a good metaphor. Okay, so I'm going to talk about science publishing, as you said. I have a couple of different kind of intermixed things I want to talk about. I want to kind of try to set the theme for what I want to talk about by laying out kind of a case for how science has failed to. God, why is my? Sorry, my watch is buzzing. I should say just at the beginning, my flight was 4 hours late. I just flew in from Washington, so if I seem a little frazzled and disheveled, it's because of that. I literally just got here. Okay, so we invented the internet, right? And it was developed starting in the 1960s, but really booming through the 1970s, 1980s, 1990s. It was developed by and for scientists with the purpose of enhancing the way that scientists can communicate with each other. Now, for most of you, the internet is something that's always been around. For the older of us, we sort of watched it be born. But back in the days before the sort of modern internet was born in the mid-1990s, the internet was pretty much exclusively an academic entity. And within academia, it was used almost exclusively by scientists, right? It was something we used to share some bits of data, to communicate a little bit. But, you know, it was developed for the explicit purpose of helping scientists share information that they were generating in their research institutions. And this is reflected on the maps of the early internet. This is a map of the internet from 1971. And you can see the major nodes on the internet were academic institutions. You know, mostly computer scientists, but you know, when I was an undergraduate, I had an internet account. And when I was in graduate school, even before the internet was a thing, we used the internet routinely to share crystallographic structure data and things like that. It was a thing that scientists, that we developed. And its whole idea was to help us, share information, right? Now, since we unleashed the internet on the rest of the world, starting sort of mid-1990s, and it became a thing, it's transformed nearly every aspect of life, right? Transformed the way we shop, it transformed the way we communicate, it's transformed basically everything we consume and everything we do. Some things seem trivial, but they're amazing in retrospect, right? I love the fact that, where's my phone? As a kid, I used to listen to baseball games on very bad radio connections from very far away. And now I can just sort of follow sporting events on my phone, no matter where they come from. You know, for example, Sorry, I had a troll the German soccer team. So, go Mexico. It's transformed literally every aspect of life except science communication, right? So, sorry, I didn't mean to play that again. It's transformed everything except the thing it was developed to transform, right? It's the ultimate irony, and in some ways the ultimate failure of science, that we invented this thing and we haven't used it. I mean, it's true at many different levels, right? Like if you look at a paper, this is a paper from the pre-internet era and the paper from the current, you know, era, they don't even look any different, right? The you know, it's kind of almost the same topic. Nature's changed their font and, you know, a little bit of the pagination. You don't really have as many of these articles that run from one page to another. But the basic way we communicate information with each other is stunningly unaltered, right? Anything else, any other form of communication, books, movies, you know, newspaper articles, magazines, everything has changed much, much, much more than science communication has. And we should all be deeply, deeply, deeply embarrassed about this, right? That, and so what I really wanna talk about mostly today is, you know, why this is true. Like, you know, what it is that we did. Well, first of all, what the consequences of this failure are, just to try to make it clear why this matters. Second, why it's true. And finally, what we should be doing to try to change it, and how we have kind of a opportunity now to undo these 25 years of failure, right? So the sort of point here is, you know, science in many ways remains stuck in the 20th century because we're still using this technology. But actually, science is actually stuck in the 17th century, right? Science journals started in the 17th century, and they're stunningly unaltered in the period of time from when the first scientific journal was published in sort of the mid 1600s by the Royal Society in London, or if you're French, by the Royal Society or the scientific societies in Paris. But it's essentially the same system that was set up by Francis Bacon and his colleagues, you know, over 350 years ago. Okay, so now I want to just go through some of the problems we have in current publishing. And I think most of these are going to be familiar with people, but I just want to emphasize them because they're so important. So first of all, what's the biggest thing the internet's done is it's democratized information, right? It's made it possible for anybody with an internet connection to get access to all sorts of different information, cat videos, porn, you know, sporting events, whatever it is. But the one thing you can't get access to on the internet reliably is scientific knowledge. And you can't get access to it because the vast majority of the scientific literature is still inaccessible to most people with an internet connection because it's behind paywalls. Probably the most efficient and effective paywalls on the internet are set up around the scientific literature, right? It's probably actually easier to get information like from the CIA archives than it is to get old papers from Nature. And that's kind of almost completely ridiculous, right? This isn't just a theoretical problem, right? Like, you know, I at Berkeley or you here at EMBL probably have access to all the papers that you need, but the vast majority of scientists around the world don't, right? And that's not just true of sort of the prototypical scientists from a poor country who can't afford to subscribe to something. It's true of most academics in the United States who are at universities or colleges where they don't have access to full subscriptions to the entire scientific literature. And if anything, their access is decreasing over time because the journals are getting more expensive and they're able to subscribe to fewer of them. Okay, and then the public is almost completely locked out from routine access to the most important parts of the scientific literature, and that's true in their, you know, whether they're just curious to get access to the information, or if they're a teacher or a doctor or just a patient who needs to know about their disease. We generate all this information largely on the public. I would say public dime, but what do you call a 10-cent piece here? With public money, and yet we don't share it with the public. Okay, so that's an old and probably the most prominent problem that we know about the scientific literature, but it's not the only one. As I mentioned, the internet should have enabled us to change the basic medium we use to communicate, right? It's we still, 25 years after the internet, it's considered like kind of a huge technological innovation if someone embeds a video in a paper, right? Whereas, you know, like the whole internet is embedded video now, and yet the scientific literature isn't like that. I think probably the greatest condemnation we can say about the scientific literature is if you imagine Francis Bacon coming to Heidelberg today, and he looks around, he'd be stunned by virtually everything about life today, cars and airplanes and electricity and televisions. And he would find solace and comfort, however, in scientific journals, right? Because he'd be like, here is the one thing from the 17th century that remains unchanged, right? Okay, that's just kind of pathetic. Okay, the system is unbelievably slow, right? Hence my t-shirt and the slogan, right? The process of peer review, it's killing us, right? It takes an incredibly long time to publish papers. So I did an analysis of this using journals that existed before the internet and that still exist today. And on average, it takes longer to publish now than it did in the years before the internet came along, despite the fact that publishing a paper used to mean printing out 4 or 5 copies, mailing it to a journal. The journal would read it on paper, decide who to review it. They would then mail those copies to the reviewers, who would print up their reviews, mail them back to the journal, who would collate the reviews, mail them to the author, who would then respond to it, make new copies of the manuscript, mail them back to the journal, sometimes mail them back to the reviewers. That whole process now takes place electronically, and yet somehow the system takes longer now than it did before. A typical paper, sort of averaged over the whole science publishing industry, takes 9 months from initial submission in the journal in which it's published. Forget about the fact that it was probably submitted to another journal previously and rejected. It takes 9 months to go from submission to publication. Okay. 9 months happens to be important time period in humans, right? So I'm not going to make another gestation analogy because I think I'll use it later. But another thing takes about 9 months to happen, which is it takes about 9 months to send a rocket from Earth to Mars when Mars is at its optimal location. And so if you had two choices between how to make your paper available to the world, and one was to send it to a scientific journal, and the other was to put it on a rocket ship with a rover and send it to Mars, have the rocket ship launch a lander to go down to the surface, bringing along this rover and your paper, and then having the rover spit your paper out onto the surface of Mars, use those cute little cameras to take pictures of it, and beam those pictures back to Earth. Okay, that would take less time than publishing in a typical scientific journal. The results would be free because these are all government-funded things, so they're beyond copyright. And here is the most amazing thing. It would be cheaper. Okay, so I estimated what it would cost to print and send every single paper published every year to Mars with its own lander and cameras to send it back to Earth. And I think I estimated fairly aggressively at about $3 billion. The primary expense here is actually just getting the papers out into orbit, right? So there's a lot of mass involved in 2 million printed scientific papers. But even using kind of old expensive prices and kind of making a kind of gold-plated rover, I estimated the cost of the rover at about $1 billion, which is a little bit more than they typically cost. It still would only cost about $3 billion to send every single paper we produce to Mars with rovers to take pictures and send them back to Earth. Just think about the fact that we actually spend three times that to not make the scientific literature available to the internet. It's completely ridiculous, right? The system is ridiculous, and there's no other way to think about it. Okay, so we spend $10 billion a year on this system. It works great, right? We get all the literature is peer-reviewed effectively. We know what's good and valid. Everybody knows which works are important, right? Of course not. It doesn't even work, right? So despite taking all this time, not making the results available to the public, and not being so expensive, it isn't very good, right? You get better reviews and better information about restaurants on the internet than you do about the scientific literature, right? So, think about if only information you ever had about a restaurant was based on two or three random people who happened to eat at that restaurant in the first 2 weeks of its existence. And then forevermore, if that was judged to be a great restaurant, right, it would have, you know, five stars or whatever you would use for your standard. And nothing that happened after that, not even if every single person who ever ate there subsequently got food poisoning and died, the standards would still be, well, the first three people who ate there thought it was great, so it's going to be that way forever. That's the way we judge the scientific literature, right? The first two or three people who read a paper and decide that it's fantastic or terrible are the only ones who matter in judging it for all eternity. And that's because we take just the standard that we take the place in which a work was published as the only valid judgment about the validity of a work forever, right? You publish a paper in Nature, it's a Nature paper on your CV forever, even if it turns out, if everybody in the field knows that it's wrong. And if you publish a paper in some obscure journal, it basically takes winning a Nobel Prize for people to ultimately recognize that this work would have been important. It's such a poor way of judging knowledge. It was developed just to deal with the limitations of print publishing. Back when you had to mail papers around the world and stuff, it made sense to kind of filter things up front. But now that we don't do that, we're just using an antiquated system for no good reason. And even worse than that, that whole process and the fact that you know, we're judged in many ways just on where we publish our work alters the way that people do science, it alters the way that people think about science, and it is just distorting the endeavor itself in fundamental ways. I happen to like this picture, so that's why I use it. I originally used it in a talk in Belgium where it was a little bit more locally appropriate, but anyway. Okay, so a lot of you already know all that stuff, but I just wanted sort of to crystallize it in one place. So those are the problems. But the real thing I want to emphasize today is that we have consistently blown our opportunities to fix it. So I'm gonna tell you about kind of how we blew it the first time and why, and then talk about sort of how I think we have a kind of new opportunity to fix it now, and I hope that we won't blow it this time and try to inspire you to participate in fixing it. Okay. So we had the internet. We were the first people to have the internet, in fact. And when we got the internet and it started to become a thing, we should have changed science publishing in accord to the new technology, and we didn't. So I'm going to tell you just about my own little story with this quickly, and this is where the microarray is going to come in, and how that, you know, I think. Most people know my involvement in science publishing around PLOS, but actually PLOS was a result of our initial failure. PLOS came into being as a response to the scientific community's sort of initial rejection of what was a much better and more far-reaching proposal that came forth in the 1990s that very few people know about. So I kind of want to give you that story. And not spend a lot of time talking about PLOS, but rather about the future. Okay, so the story actually does begin with the DNA microarray. So for those of you who don't know, this is a DNA microarray. It is a piece of a microscope slide, or zoomed-in portion of a microscope slide, onto which are spotted basically every single open reading frame from the yeast genome. So one of those little spots is a PCR product containing a single, a well from a 96-well plate with a PCR product from a single yeast open reading frame. What you're seeing there is salt, not the actual DNA, so that's why it's visible. But these were, before DNA sequencing became cheap and fast, this was how we analyzed things on a genome-wide scale. So these were first developed in the mid-1990s, and one of the places they were developed was in the lab of Pat Brown, who was my sort of co-postdoctoral mentor with David Botstein. And I got to Pat's lab sort of right after they sort of developed the technology. And we started to do the first experiments with these yeast and then ultimately human DNA microarrays. So again, for those of you who grew up in the genomics era, this is not surprising. But back in my PhD, which was done in the pre-genomics era, I worked on two proteins, And that was actually kind of a lot. The other people in my lab only worked on one. And by the time I'd finished my PhD, I had a stack of papers on my desk that was the entire literature that was published on those two proteins. Okay? Literally every paper, or at least every paper that was in the library at Harvard, which probably meant it was close to every paper that had ever been published on those two genes. And while I won't say I'd read every single one of them in detail, I had looked at every single one of them. I knew what it contained. And if something happened in my research, I had in my head sufficient knowledge of the literature on those two genes that I could immediately relate it to something that had been published. Okay, so now I go start my postdoc, and all of a sudden I'm doing experiments with 6,000 genes instead of two. I don't have the world's best memory compared to other people, but even if I did, it's just not possible to have absorbed, even at this time when the literature was pretty scant. You know, when I was doing this work, there were about 50,000 papers out there that had described in one way or another something useful about literature on a single yeast gene. Okay, and then for humans, it was much bigger. There was no way you could have absorbed that knowledge into your head. And in the era when it was stored in these print journals that we had in libraries, there's not much you could have done, right? Like there was, you know, it wouldn't help to have a stack of 50,000 papers on my desk because I didn't know what was where, and I couldn't parse all this information. If I found something interesting with one gene and I tried to go into the literature, it just wouldn't work. But coincidentally, or maybe not entirely coincidentally, the birth of these genomic experiments coincided with the growth of the modern internet. And with the growth of the modern internet happened something important, which was that scientific journals started to put their contents online, right? So again, it's hard probably for some people to accept that there was a period of time when there were no electronic versions of articles. And once this happened, once we started, this is the first version of the PNAS website I could dig up from the Internet Archive. So very slick, right? This is when they were going to announce that they were going to be available online, right? This was such a revolutionary thing for scientists back in the day that all of a sudden we'd actually be able to get access to scientific literature on our computers instead of having to go to a library. And it didn't take long for us to realize that there was a research opportunity in this shift. In particular, that if all those 45,000 papers on yeast were now going to be available electronically, that I could actually start writing, you know, software that would take the genes, the gene expression data we were generating in the lab, and take the literature that was available on the computer, and put it together in some way. I didn't know exactly how, but one never really does when you start doing these things. I just thought we'd have these two pieces of data, and we'd figure out some useful way to integrate them. And it just so happened, again, semi-coincidentally, that the primary publisher, online publisher for most of scientific journals that were going online, was Highwire Press, which was originally located in the Stanford libraries. So this was about, you know, a kilometer from where my lab is. I think a kilometer. I don't know how big that is, but it was nearby. It was about a 5-minute walk from our lab. So Pat and I and a couple other people from the lab, we literally ordered a disk. I'm anachronistic. We didn't order it. We went to a store and bought a disk. And we had a disk, and I can't remember what it was, maybe like 200 megabytes or something. The biggest disk we could buy. And we literally brought this down to the Stanford libraries, to guys who ran Highwire Press, and we said, we'd like the whole scientific literature on a disk, please. And you know, they had it on some computer in the back room. We figured they'd be excited to give us this literature that they were developing this new technology. They'd be excited to share it with us. And it's easily the single most shocking moment in my scientific career when the head of Highwire Press said no. Not, what do you want to do with it? You know, how can we help you? But he said, no, we can't give you this information because you don't own it. Right? And so it was the first time in my life that I'd come to the realization that the scientific community does something just insane, which is we take all the knowledge that we generate in our labs, the papers that we write, the papers that we review, and we give it to journals and let them decide who can use it, how much you have to pay, and how it's shared. So, And then it turns out, you know, we discovered pretty quickly that science, where science was innovating in the internet was not in how to make information available. It was how to make information not available. Okay, so the biggest innovation in science publishing in the early 1990s was the development of the paywall. Okay, was figuring out how to charge for information online. And again, science journals were amongst the first to start businesses on the internet that charged for access to published material. Most other people just threw stuff up online and hoped anybody would read it. Science journals were amongst the first to say, hey, no, you have to pay to get any access to this information. So Pat was kind of a visionary. By the way, you're not interrupting me. Interrupt me. I know I talk fast, but please, if you have questions or you disagree with me, maybe I'm just being completely agreeable. So Pat got really pissed off about this. And you know, I was a postdoc at the time. I didn't yet have the kind of worldview that Pat instilled in me, which was, when you see a problem like this, think about ways you can fix it. But Pat did. And Pat's first instinct was to say, well, this is ridiculous. Let's just burn the whole system down, okay? And it was the right instinct, and it's the one we should have followed. So Pat, fortunately had a good connection in this world, and Pat had been a postdoc in Mike Bishop's lab at UCSF, and Mike Bishop was a very close collaborator with Harold Varmus, and so they had kind of the same lab, and Harold Varmus at the time was the director of the National Institutes of Health, and so Pat met with Harold at this cafe. This will mean nothing to you if you don't live in San Francisco, but anyway. Pat met at this cafe, and they started to hatch a plan. And the plan, it ultimately involved David Lippmann and me and a few other people were sort of kibitzing on it, but really this was a plan from Pat and Harold. And they basically reinvented the whole scientific publishing endeavor, okay? And they said, okay, let's just assume journals disappear. What do we want science publishing to look like? And the product of that was something called eBiomed. And maybe Maria has heard about this, but probably the only person here who knows about eBiomed. It was something that Harold proposed in 1999. It's the US government, and so he couldn't just do it. He had to propose it and had to get comments and other things. But let me tell you about what the proposal was. And there's a lot of details here, and some of the details maybe were imperfect in their conception. But the basic idea of eBiomed was simple, and it's described in this idea that the essential feature is simplified, instantaneous, cost-free access to the entire contents of, you know, essentially they were thinking about all the NIH-funded research, which is a large fraction of the published biomedical research literature, that you would get access to this information at the NIH's website or at the NCBI's website, where PubMed currently is, and you could use that information. You get access to the information for free. You could use it for whatever purposes you want to, and so forth. That they wanted to create a giant library that would have the entire contents of the scientific literature at your fingertips for free. Something that the internet enabled that we should have done, and yet which remarkably we still don't have. And we don't have it because of the way that people responded to eBiomed. Okay. So I should say that, you know, the idea was to not only just to make stuff freely available, but also to change the way that we reviewed the literature. And I think there was a little bit more complexity in the plan, but the basic idea was to say, well, this whole system we have of thousands and thousands of journals where you submit your paper to one journal, they review it, it goes back and forth in this crazy circuitous manner that the way we fund it is stupid. You know, the NIH gives money to libraries, you take that money to universities, who take that money and give it to libraries, who take that money and give it to journals through subscriptions. Your readers get, someone pays for their access, but they're never really sure who. And it's a Byzantine system that evolved to serve the print era, but didn't make sense in the internet era. And that you would replace it with a simple world in which every paper, I want to try to say this in a glowing tone, every paper would appear in this giant database for free. That on top of this entity where you could get access to everything for free, we would layer peer review on top of it, where articles would get reviewed. They'd get reviewed maybe by editorial boards, maybe by individuals, maybe by groups that were formed explicitly for the purpose of reviewing literature, but that this editorial review would happen above and beyond the and independent of the raw access to the information, that is, you're decoupling publication and review, and that it would happen for as long as the paper was useful to people, right? Not just at the point it was published, it would go on forever. This is the ideal state. I still think this is the ideal state of the literature. eBiomed was an entirely visionary thing in my mind. It would have provided free access to the literature to anybody with an internet connection. And yes, it was only the NIH, but given the amount of money that the NIH spends on things, that if it had happened with the NIH, it would have happened everywhere. It would have streamlined the process of peer review to make it work in a much more sane and kind of way that takes advantage of the internet. And it would have done something I think also incredibly important, which was it would have gotten funders to recognize that they are already funding the way that science is communicated, but they kind of all the parts of science, funders just sort of throw up their hands and say, we're not gonna get involved in publishing, right? That we're gonna spend $100 billion or something on biomedical research worldwide. We're gonna make sure that everybody does it in an ethical way, that we're gonna make sure you do the right kind of experiments. We have this whole system to make sure that only the people who are proposing the right things get grants. And then at the end of that, right at the end, when you finally produce some knowledge that's potentially useful to people, they're going to be like, "Eh, do whatever you want with it. It doesn't really matter, right?" This is kind of insane. Okay, so Harold, as I said, couldn't just implement this on his own. He had to go through this comment period. The comments were generally favorable. Most people who wrote in about it said, "Hey, I think this is a great idea. Here's sort of a synthesis of some of those things. I can't wait. It's exactly what I've been longing for. I support it. Excellent idea, long overdue." These were the kind of typical comments that came in on the websites, quite different than what you get on government proposals today. Nowadays you get, "That's the most evil thing I've ever heard." But okay, so if you look at the bulk of the comments from academics, from doctors, people who work for the government, patients, et cetera, they were positive. But then there's this kind of unfortunate category down at the bottom, which involved editors, society officials, and commercial publishers. So you'll notice that at the top, the comments tended to lean in supportive. Down at the bottom, the comments tended to lean to the negative. And you know, once the journals took notes and the scientific societies took note of this, it was dead. And there were the comments, you know, they had editorials, right? eBiomed proposal is a potential threat to the evaluation and orderly dissemination of clinical studies, right? People wrote, "I'm very concerned, it's unwise and ill-advised. The proposal is so horrible that it's amongst the very worst ideas I've ever heard." This is the full quote there. "I don't get involved in these things very often, but let me just say that the publication of an electronic journal supported by the NIH as described in the Varma proposal is amongst the very worst ideas I've ever heard," right? So think about it. This is an idea whose sole purpose was to try to improve the way that science is communicated, to improve the way that we review the literature, to make it more efficient and effective, and yet all these people who were affiliated with scientific societies and journals, they wanted to kill it. So unfortunately, they have more power than Sanity and the rest of the public, and they did kill it. Okay, so you know, they killed it. They went to their people, and their members of Congress, who they give money to, and they said, "Kill this proposal." Congress killed this proposal, and it never got off the ground. So this opportunity we had, you know, we had a NIH director who wanted to do it. We had a decent proposal. We had general support from the scientific community to do something like this, and it didn't happen because institutions in science didn't want it to happen. Okay, so now I'm going to zoom through what happened in the next 20 years, because mostly you know more about this than you know about the past, and then I want to finish up by talking about the future. So there has been some progress, and I'm going to go through this quickly because I want to save time for discussion. eBiomed morphed. It became PubMed Central. And its salient feature changed. Its salient feature was that it was going to be a place where all scientific literature was published initially, and that where review would happen, to a place where things went to be made available after they went to journals and were available. It allowed, it was bad in a bunch of ways, most importantly that it allowed delays between publication and free availability of up to a year. And critically, it was also just voluntary. Journals could participate if they wanted to, but they didn't have to. It got off to a slow start. Very few journals agreed to participate early on. Pat and I thought that was ridiculous, so we tried to sort of rally the scientific community behind this by kind of organizing a boycott where people said that if you don't play and participate in PubMed Central, we won't send you our papers or review for you. That was actually where the name Public Library of Science came from. We've said we want people to create a Public Library of Science. You can tell this is from the early 2000s because of the font. By the time this was all done, we had 30,000 people from scientists from all over the world who had pledged to not participate in not play with journals who didn't participate in PubMed Central. But the journals were we're going to call your bluff. We don't believe that people will shun us. And they were right, because the scientific community was just not ready to give up journals. You probably won't know this, but this is my favorite English king. His name is Ethelred the Unready. So sort of a patron saint of scientists. So we had to figure out what to do next, and that's where PLOS came from, which was a response to the fact that scientists said, well, we like the idea, but we don't have any journals that we can send our papers to. And so we said, okay, somewhat reluctantly, because I didn't really want to spend my time starting journals. This is just some early descriptions. I think I have this here because New York Times, my first moment of fame, the New York Times wrote an article about PLOS. They quoted me extensively and then used a picture of Pat over my name. So my mom, who, I'm on the West Coast. My mom was on the East Coast, so she got the New York Times before I did. And she called me up, and she's just like, I don't think that's you. So anyway, the critical thing about this article was that Ed Penhote, who was the director of the Moore Foundation, who funded us, he said, yeah, I think in the short term they'll still be publishing in Cell, but in the long term I think it has the potential to dramatically facilitate science. But the more important part of his quote was, scientists are a conservative bunch. And this is really this thing that's always shocked me about this, is, we're supposed to be radical, right? We're supposed to be rewarded for coming up with creative new ideas and being risk-taking in our research, but in our actual lives as scientists, we're incredibly conservative, right? I don't think I'm gonna be fully able to re-quote this tweet, but it was someone wrote something like, how is it that so many scientists are, lefties in their political life, but in their scientific life, they're Randian oligarchical capitalists, right? We support this incredibly hierarchical, it's almost a monarchy of science where we concentrate power in relatively few organizations. They judge us from afar, and we kind of just say, okay, I accept your judgment, and what's more, I'm going to submit to your judgment continuously until you praise me. And it's a really terrible system. Okay, and yet it keeps going. Okay, so PLOS, you know about PLOS. PLOS, grew. It grew fast. It's grown a lot. Lots of people have copied it. Open access has grown. I'm distilling 20 years down into 2 minutes. PubMed Central, in many ways, is actually now thriving, and it's thriving in part because the NIH finally got their act together and started to require that its authors put their papers in there, and whether the journals liked it or not. But that still has not. Unlike what we anticipated, this hasn't really broken the back of the system. It's kind of given us a pressure release valve so that you can get access to information. But in many ways, we're still where we were 20 years ago. That journals still dominate the way that we think about science. That yes, information is more available. And you know, if you count Sci-Hub and other pirate places, you can actually get access to a lot of information. And I think that's fantastic. I think Sci-Hub is the coolest thing that's happened in science publishing for decades. And right, that should also be a condemnation for us, that the best thing that's happened in science communication is basically piracy and awesome piracy. But it's like we should be better than that, right? And I think at the end of the day, it's because we, and by we, I mean me and Pat and Harold, when we started they were publishing, we made a huge mistake. And we didn't realize something about publishing, which we thought, and I think there were good reasons to think this, that the big problem we had back in the day was about access to the literature, right? That the internet was all about access to information, that the scientific community had failed to provide access to the literature, and we tried to fix that problem, okay? And I do think in some ways we have fixed that problem, or at least heading along the way of fixing that problem. But it turns out that we fixed a problem, but we didn't fix the problem, okay? And so what is the problem? And the problem is that we were attacking the funding of journals. Like, so PLOS is really ultimately about how we pay for publishing, right? It's about saying that paying by subscriptions is a bad idea because in order to have subscriptions, you have to deny access to people who don't pay. Since the money's coming from the research community anyway, we might as well just pay up front and we can buy the access, you know, forever. This is where you can use a sort of gestation model. I told you I would come back to gestation, right? Like the current journal publishing system, the subscription model is one, it's like if you imagine you go to the, you're about to have a baby, you go to the doctor, go to the obstetrician, they deliver the baby, right? The obstetrician plays an important role in the process, just kind of like journals play an important role in the process, although I'd say obstetricians are more important than journals. But imagine if the business model that obstetricians used was that they would take ownership of the baby, right? And then lease it back to the parents on an annual basis, right? They could charge whatever they wanted to. It would be an insane model. It'd be great business for them, but no one would let them get away with it. But we let journals get away with basically the same thing. So that was the problem we were attacking with PLOS. But the problem is that the problem really isn't how we fund journals, it's that we have journals, right? And I think we were eBiomed attacked the basic idea that journals should exist. But because eBiomed failed, we kind of felt, well, people want journals, so let's try to undermine the system from within, and I don't think that worked as well as we wanted it to. And I do think sorry for the journal publishers here, but I think it's one way or another, everything bad in science stems from our addiction to journals. Not exactly not that journals exist, right? So some journals do good things and people involved in journals are adding value to the literature. It's not that the journals exist, it's that we've become addicted to them in all sorts of ways within our lives. First thing to realize is, journals, right? We don't need journals to publish things, right? That's what they traditionally did. We traditionally had journals because we didn't have printing presses in our labs, so we needed journals to do things. But in the internet age, publishing is just a button. Right, you can publish things by pressing a button, and there's the biggest fundamental thing that's changed. Right, is that the means of communication are completely different, and they let you, they allow you to just make your work freely available with the push of a button. So we don't depend on journals to publish, because we have other ways of doing it. But we do depend on journals right now. They do all sorts of things in the community, right? They manage peer review. So we all agree literature has to be reviewed in some way or another. We need to share our thoughts on what's good, what's bad, what's right, what's wrong, what's useful, et cetera. They help tell us what to read, right? So they do serve that service. They help decide who's doing good science. The last two are where it gets kind of more complicated and bad, which is they basically decide who gets jobs. Right? I mean, yeah, there's a little bit of fuzz around the edge, but more or less, in order to get good jobs in this world, you have to publish in the right journals. Not everywhere, not every time, but to a large extent. And they help decide who can get funded. Okay? And ostensibly, there's really scientists who are making those decisions behind the journals, but in practice, the journals and their business models and the way they are structured are the ones that decide a lot of these things, and it's not being done efficiently or effectively, and I think I've kind of said this in other ways before, you know, we're effectively paying publisher $10 billion a year to oversee a process where we do all the critical work, and they don't even do it well, right? And again, not that the journals individually don't operate in their own niche well, it's that the system as a whole doesn't do this job efficiently, it doesn't do it effectively, and it does it in a very incomplete way. Okay, so I want to finish up by saying that, you know, really, we don't need journals at all, okay? And, can you see who that is? Yeah, and it's a little dark image. But we can have a world without journals. It's sitting there for the taking right in front of us, and all it takes is for us to have just a little bit of moxie and that sounds like a German word. A little bit of courage to go out and change the system now that we have kind of a new opportunity to do so. And the new opportunity to do so is the growth of preprints, right? So preprints through bioarchive are great. The physicists realized this long ago. The biologists have been decades too late. But bioarchive is a manifestation of the publishing is a button philosophy in biomedical research. It grew for all sorts of interesting reasons, and we could talk about why preprints have taken off now as opposed to other points in the past when they could have. But they, you know, preprints embody a simple principle that I think everybody kind of admits, which is that it makes more sense for you to be able to publish when you as a scientist think your work is ready, okay? Not to have to go through hoops to get your work out there. And I think, you know, the fact that publishing has gotten so difficult and challenging and takes a long time and is kind of, you know, increasingly annoying, where journals want you to do more and more stuff, is part of the reason why people were willing to just sort of go with a new system. But preprints solve a lot of the problems in the system, right? They allow you to make your work instantly available and actually fairly visible. I think people are realizing that preprints are not just a way of in principle making your work available. That actually being able to get your work out quickly is actually very valuable to authors. Okay, so preprints are growing. They're still a tiny fraction of the total biomedical literature, but they're growing. But there's a problem, which is that even though bioarchive has been born with the idea that it can live in kind of symbiosis with journals, it can't really. Okay, so right now you can submit your papers to bioarchive and then submit them to a journal, and everything's fine. You can have sort of the best of both worlds. But as bioarchive continues to grow, and it becomes the place where you get your papers, one of two things will happen. Possibility number one, which is the good possibility, is that it'll just keep growing and everybody will send their papers there, and now you will no longer go to journals to get access to information. The primary point of getting access to the scientific literature will be through bioarchive, or maybe its successor, or maybe some super archive, who knows what you want to call it. But that you'll get access to papers when people want to make them available. And journals will wither away, because journals can't survive economically in a world in which everything is freely available online, right? Like if everybody used Sci-Hub, right? If Sci-Hub was universal and it didn't, you know, get shut off in countries or forced to change its URL or make you think you were being infected with Russian malware every time you logged on, journals would disappear tomorrow, because it undermines their basic economic principle that they're based on, which is that someone's going to pay for access to information. I can tell you, my university, you know, we're reasonably, you know, well off compared to the rest of the world, but we're always in tight budget situation. If our librarians knew we could get access to all that information for free, even if it was illegal, they would cancel subscriptions to journals tomorrow, right? So and bioarchive offers a way for that to happen completely legally. And if it just continues to grow, journals will have to change or disappear because their business model can't survive. But the darker side of this is, this is not news to journals, right? They agree to sort of live with bioarchive right now because it actually isn't hurting their business. But if it does start to hurt their business, it is entirely possible that journals will say, yeah, we let you play around with bioarchive for a while, but now no more. If you want to publish in Cell or Nature or wherever, you can't have posted it on bioarchive first. And people will be forced to make a choice, And we know from past experience that when scientists are forced to choose between doing the right thing and getting into the journals, and again, this is not a criticism, this is a natural response to the constraints we're putting on people, that they will choose to continue to publish in journals. It's inevitable. So how do we prevent that from happening? We prevent that from happening by creating a system that provides all the things that journals provide to us, but that works off of bioarchive as its basic platform. And I want to finish by just laying out what that's going to look like, or at least in my mind. So if we're going to do this, we have to reinvent peer review. We can't just have bioarchive, right? It's, you know, at its limit, 2 million papers a year are going into bioarchive and just sitting there. Yeah, you could get access to all sorts of stuff, but invariably we're going to want to know what's good, what's bad, what should I read, what shouldn't I read, and it needs a lot of this infrastructure that exists in journals to be replicated in preprints. You know, from my point of view, there's kind of just some simple principles that what do we want to fix? We want to change the way that review works so that you're actually serving science and scientists rather than journals. There's some overlap there. Some of the things we do to review for journals is actually useful to scientists, but some of the things we'd like review to do don't get done because it's not really interesting to journals to have it done. We want review to be something that happens for the entire useful lifetime of papers, right? Like the, one of the worst things that happens now is that papers are only reviewed at one fixed point in time by two or three people on an airplane traveling to a meeting, right? I think the third thing that I think is super, super important is that we change to a world in which reviewing becomes part of your life as a scientist in pursuing your research, not something you do as a begrudging favor for an email server that sends you a thing asking you to submit a review, right? That right now we have this weird world where we volunteer our effort to review papers, but most of the time we're reviewing papers we wouldn't have read otherwise. And that takes time away from actually reading papers. And we just don't have a culture, because it doesn't match with the way we assess people's work. We don't have a culture where you ever review things that you actually read, right? So if you read a paper today and you think it's brilliant or you think it's crap, if you're not a reviewer, it doesn't matter what you think, basically. And so you don't share it with the world. And the way we're thinking about this and thinking about how to implement these kind of systems is to rethink peer review around the idea that when you review a paper, you're reviewing for four distinct audiences. You're reviewing for the author, right? So I read, you know, if I read someone's paper and I have ideas about things that they could do better or new experiments or things like that, I'm reviewing for the author and I can share information with the author in various ways. That is part of the current peer review system, right? It's probably the one piece that works in a reasonably efficient way, which is we have feedback for the author. But we also want to serve readers. So if you choose to read a paper and someone else has read it before you, their thoughts and, you know, about what's good, what's bad in the paper, but also how to contextualize it, what else you should be reading, what other ideas are connected, that's incredibly useful. We basically don't share that information at all, right? The only thing you as a reader know about peer review was that it was accepted, right? And many of the things that would be useful for potential readers to know about a paper that you've already read, we have no way of recording or transmitting that information to future readers. A great value if I read a paper in helping potential readers, right? So if I've read a paper and I think, wow, this is super interesting to anybody who studies transcription in the Drosophila embryo, then I should be able to say that. And anybody who works on transcription in the Drosophila embryo, where's Justin? I saw you out there. that it would say, hey, Justin, here's a paper for you to read, right? That's really useful knowledge that we currently embed in journal titles, but very, very inefficiently and ineffectively. And then finally, there's this category that we all seem to care most about, which is people who are never going to read your paper in the world. Wait, this is one of the weirdest things about the journal publishing world. Is that almost all of peer review's value, as we in our current system, is accrued by the information about peer review going to people who are never going to read that paper at all, right? Most of the people we care about, the people who decide on who to hire, the people who decide on who to give grants to and things like that, the only reason we need a journal title is because they don't want to read the paper. They just want to know, is it valuable? So there's this weird thing where we have to serve people who are never going to read these papers. And so we have a whole infrastructure and $10 billion a year whose basic service is primarily to people who are never going to read the scientific literature. And so we do, and you know, it's naive to say it's naive to say, well, you should only hire people if you've read 10 of their papers, right? It's not going to happen because time doesn't work that way, and sometimes people just aren't experts in the field. So we need some system in which when you review a paper, you communicate to people who care about the quality of the research done by the scientists and how important and impactful it is and whether or not it signifies that they're going to do good work in the future. But we need to share that information in a way that isn't just a journal title. There's better ways of doing it. So those are the audiences we want for peer review. I think we can do a much better job of conveying information about what you think about a paper just directly by breaking down the peer review process into these 4 points. I don't know exactly how to get everybody to do it. I think the big challenge now is, I was just talking to Maria about this before. It's a miracle that people participate in peer review, right? I mean, there's something like 4 to 5 million peer review events in the biomedical literature every year, or in slightly bigger than the biomedical literature, the STEM literature. That's amazing, right? That 5 million times someone says, I'm going to read a paper for some journal and I'm going to comment on it. It just shows that we're basically good people, right? More people should cheat in this system, right? Like any game theory model would tell you that the best strategy for you is to never review papers. Because you should be spending your time doing science, and this is taking away from your time doing science. You're certainly, if you want to read papers during that time, almost, I would say, if your goal is to do better science, you'd be better off reading papers that you think are important than papers that someone else thinks that would like you to read. The optimal strategy for you as an individual is to not review. And yet, because you get no rewards for it. And yet everybody does it. So the question is that because we're all basically good people and we would participate in the system no matter what, especially if it were open? Or is there some kind of weird alchemy that exists with journals and that if we got rid of journals, this would all just vaporize and people would realize that the whole system is stupid and that they shouldn't participate? I don't know. But that's really the big challenge, is how to get people to participate in a system in kind of a new world. And I'm going to end with, it's perfect time to talk. I'm just going to end and say, now's the time to do this, right? We have an opportunity. BioArchive gives us the basis for doing this. If we fail BioArchive, if we fail to do it now, I can't see that we're ever going to do it. And so I just encourage everybody to just start thinking about what we should be doing. There are nascent efforts to try to build review systems around BioArchive. There are more coming, and I just think this is the time, and I'd love to take your questions and talk about it. So.
I think the first person to raise her hand was here.
So I raised my hand because I didn't want you to move the slide.
Okay, I can go back.
The reason I raised my hand, the point, because we know all these, that this is important, and we know that BioArchive exists. So why doesn't BioArchive allow every reader to endorse certain part of that paper?
I think BioArchive is trying to do that, but BioArchive is in a little bit of a weird situation because they view themselves as existing in a world in which they are not threats to journals. So BioArchive is a little reluctant as an entity to participate in, you know, taking over journal functions, basically, like peer review. So they have comments, right? And I think they're working to build more infrastructure to support people doing that. But they don't want to actually get involved in the process of encouraging people to do it and managing it and things like that. It's a little bit of a, perhaps it's a distinction that doesn't matter. But BioArchive has money now to fund technology development, so the papers will look like real papers. They won't just be PDFs that people post. That will at least make it possible for people to comment on BioArchive articles and leave those comments, even though BioArchive itself won't sort of organize the process, they're making it easy for other people to do so. So that function will exist. The question is, right now, it already exists. Not exactly what you want, but you can already comment on bioarchive articles. Just nobody does it, right? And the reason nobody does it is that they don't see a value in doing so, right? If the only thing that matters is where a paper is published, then why put in the time to comment on something if you don't think anybody's going to look at it? And actually, I think comment has this weird property that it's simultaneous. It's like a Schrodinger's thing. It's simultaneously visible to everybody, but also to nobody, because anybody can read it forever, and it's going to be there forever. But you have no guarantee that anybody will ever care, and so it doesn't. People don't do it because it doesn't matter. So I think even if they built a system where you could comment on specific pieces of paper and so forth, which is a really important and useful thing, we need somehow to change the culture in the community so that people do it because they think it matters. And once they start doing it and once it starts mattering, then more people will do it. But that is coming, that facility.
I just meant not for the commenting, but just yes or no survey.
You mean just like Amazon, like thumbs up, thumbs down, kind of. Yeah, so again, I think bioarchive will facilitate somebody else coming along and creating that kind of assessment, and then they will allow those things to be attached to bioarchive. So the basic mechanics behind being able to do that are going to exist imminently. The question is, and people are already starting up, there's like maybe a dozen little efforts to do what people call now overlay journals on top of bioarchive, where you can do various versions of that. But at the moment, nobody's using them. So the trick is to get everybody to start using them, to have them start mattering, and then more people will do them. So I think there's one back there. Okay.
Well, just a question. You said the problem is that you want to get people involved in the reviewing, for instance, so on. I mean, and that the basic problem is, do you get no reward?
Yeah.
So maybe, I don't know, just trying to get such a system that you need to review a paper every 10 you read, for instance, but making it like mandatory to get in contact with the authors. So you get the reward as a making network as well. I mean, your blog, keep reading papers, you make the network with proper people that make you benefits you in the future, for instance. Some kind of this work.
I think this has been something people have discussed for a long time. I'd say maybe generalize it around the idea of what is the right kind of way to incentivize people to participate, and what do people get by doing peer review. So one thing, right now, I mean, what do people get out of it? They get a feeling that they're helping to protect the literature from bad ideas, which, when your job is to produce good ideas, that's an important thing, but it's very indirect. It doesn't accrue to them in a direct way. It's sort of about the field. Maybe they get some like social currency with the journal. So they think, if I review papers for this journal, then when I submit a paper to this journal, they'll treat me better. But that doesn't explain why people review for Plos One or something where it doesn't matter. And then, but this social currency that you get as a reviewer, right now you don't get any of that because it's all anonymous, right? So my feeling is that people don't, either they don't think that that's really that strong a currency, or they don't think they're going to get, or they think it could be, but it isn't right now, because there's nothing that stops you right now, right, from reading a paper and contacting the authors and saying, hey, I thought this was really useful and interesting. But a lot less of that happens than you might think if people thought that that kind of thing was a good way of, building out your career. So, I don't know, most people probably the same way, like not a ton of direct feedback on my papers when I publish them. And maybe no one cares, and maybe that's no one reading them. But they're citing them, so at least they're supposed to be reading them. And it is true that there's very, very limited kind of social network built around communicating about papers. And I don't know whether that's because people don't actually value it, or because we don't have a good way of of making it happen. I do think it would be great if part of what came out of this was, you know, one of the things that people have to be willing to do is to be more open about their reviews, right? If you want to get credit for your reviews, you have to tell people who you are. And right now, right, you know, we mostly review anonymously. And so one of the things that you sort of have to get used to is the idea that when you review something, it's going to be public. I don't, you know, but I don't, I, you know, it's one of the big questions is how to do that.
Thank you. So peer review does improve papers, I would think. So probably the version that is published is better than the version that was sent first. At least I would say
that for my papers. I've done a few little experiments with this, and by, you know, if you ignore, I would say, cosmetics like grammar, you know, figure legends, things like that, do get better from peer review. But if you ignore that, I think our, you know, haven't done these in a thorough or scientific enough way, but when we've given people papers pre and post peer review and asked them to tell us which one was which, most people can't tell you. And so it's I think my experience as an author is 50-50. Sometimes papers get better, sometimes they get worse. And you know, because yes, feedback is useful, but the system simultaneously gives you feedback and issues constraints, right? So, you know, it tells you here are things that can make your paper better, but then it also says you can't include this idea or you have to do this. And I think there's a dueling problem that peer review offers useful comments and offers constraints. And I'm not sure that one, you know, that one is better than the others.
Yeah, we'll publish, or the editor said, we'll publish this paper if you leave out the new evidence that contradicts what XYZ published.
Yeah. This happens all the time. So let me say that I do think that, you know, whether comments make a paper better or not is something that should be a decision to be left to the authors, right? So I think in any effective system, you want to have versioning of papers. So you want it for possible for authors to respond to comments or not respond to comments, and to have that be open and transparent so that, you know, you post a version of the paper, people comment on it. If the authors think something is useful, they can respond to it and alter their paper. If they don't, I think authors should have the complete discretion to ignore comments they don't like and then be judged for it, right? If they ignore things that are important, then they'll be judged negatively for it. If they take bad comments, they'll be judged negatively. I think the idea that we're gonna box authors in to the whims of you know, reviewers and editors, even when they're good and right, I think is itself just not a, it overly homogenizes the way that things happen, and I think it's ultimately counterproductive. So the price we pay for the times that papers get better is that oftentimes they get worse, and we wrest from authors the ability to express themselves in the way that they think is best. And I think that diminishes science for having done so. Sorry.
Because in physicists, all still publishing in journals, and why? Because it's all driven by, as you said, the stratification of science that journals provide, and that's going to get both.
Yeah.
Okay. Just
I can tell you, right? So the concern is that actually it's not true that preprints will undermine journals, because they haven't done so in physics. And my again, this is pure speculation, but my feeling is that the reason that there hasn't been a wholesale abandonment of subscriptions to physics journals by libraries, even though you can get all that information for free in archive, is that it's not that much money. Compared to the biomedical literature, the amount you would save by canceling physics journals is a rounding error. And again, I don't know this to be true, but my feeling is that if all the biomedical literature were all of a sudden available for free, and the, you know, the UC libraries saw a $35 million a year budget line that they could cancel with no consequence for their authors, I think they would cancel it in a heartbeat.
But the only point I wanted to make as a corollary of that is it doesn't really matter if you call it journal or not journal. I think the drive of all of this is research assessment and using papers or whatever you call it as a unit, as a currency. And it's good to have this discussion about the quality of peer review, because I think that's what we really have to address.
Yeah,
it's not the journal name, whatever you put the whatever label you put on the bin, but the process itself.
Yeah, it's definitely a "the king is dead, long live the king" kind of thing. I mean, the sense that we want there to be peer review and we want there to be research assessment. And the problem with the current system is it does it poorly, right? Like, it's not that it does peer review. It's that it does it poorly, slowly, ineffectively, and expensively, right? We want the function. We just do it in an incredibly ineffective, inefficient, and antiquated way. So it's not that we want to destroy it, we want to rebuild it.
Just for sake of transparency, I'm one of the editors. In a way, you've done this before with Wikipedia. So you build a huge database of all the knowledge in the world that spelled the end of the Encyclopedia Britannica, and then everybody was contributing and build up Wikipedia. It was this wonderful thing where you can get to know anything you even didn't know it existed. But the problem is, it now reached a point where even the founders of Wikipedia concede that it's not working anymore.
Yeah.
And that it's just a handful of senior administrators who engage themselves in endless flame wars, and people like Jérôme Lanier basically say, you can't trust it anymore, what is in there, because the place is run by a couple
It's really not senior editors, like 16-year-old hackers, right? Like, yeah. I went to a Wikipedia conference where I met all the like senior editors, and it's like, I mean, they're amazing people, but you're right. It's astonishing how few people actually manage Wikipedia.
So the one thing is, how do you prevent this from happening if you have a system which looks in a way a bit like Wikipedia? The other thing is, and that was also back the discussion about eBiomed, is if you have a monolithic system, and that was one of the points about Biomed, if you have a monolithic system where everybody submits their paper, where all the peer review is organized, and that thing is in the United States of America, who prevents anyone from just switching it off?
Right, so
if funding goes off, or who controls what goes in there? Who decides what is?
Wait, are you saying you don't trust the U.S. government? Wait, so, so two parts, right? So I want to be clear. I do not think Wikipedia is the right model here, right? I'm looking at it the following way. Wikipedia's problem is there isn't money to do it right. Like Wikipedia is about, you know, it's basically about doing it for free and relying on people whose time has no value basically to them. So they're willing to participate in trying to, you know, fight about who invented chess, right? And we in science clearly value this service, right? We express with our money the fact that we deeply value the role that editors and sort of grown-ups play in managing peer review, okay? So I didn't want to imply you guys are grown-ups, but the problem is, like, we should keep doing that, right? If I offered you $10 billion a year to manage peer review in an effective, efficient way with, you know, hired senior people and smart people who were committed to doing this, you could run a really, really, really good system, right? The problem isn't, right, it's not that we want to do away with the infrastructure for peer review. It's not that we want to do away with having an organized system to ensure civility and honesty and that people aren't conflicted. It's that the current one does it poorly. And that, like, I think, you know, again, if someone said, I give you $10 billion a year to run this system, I could retire in a month, right? Like, it was so much less money is required to do it well. We just have to be willing to redirect the money that we currently spend, most of which just disappears in inefficiency in publishing and other things, and hire, I don't know, how many editors could you hire for $10 billion a year? 10 and make them all rich? I don't know, the point is, this is not a plea for anarchy. This is a plea for stepping back, taking the resources we currently deploy to publish the literature and use them in a way that is actually achieving the goals we want to as a scientific community, right? The anarchic model is not going to work because the second a system, any system becomes valuable and important, people will manipulate it and corrupt it, and we're all venal in many different ways. So we have to have an independent system of doing this. And again, I also agree, like every time I go anywhere near the US government, what they do is completely inefficient and you wouldn't want them running anything, right? Like you don't want that to be the case. You want the US government and every other government to have access to the information and to archive it and to share it freely. But I agree more than anybody that I wouldn't want any single entity in charge of anything. It's just that you know, the information is out there. Lots of people can participate in managing it. There's no need to have a centralized, you know, bureaucracy around it.
My question is related to two things that you have mentioned. One is the issue of the financial one, meaning that some journals make a lot of profit and then they impose a fee on, and this would be very easy to fix. The other...
I thought that 25 years ago and it hasn't changed, so it's not as easy as it seems, but yeah.
But I mean, it seems to me that is just a decision that is up to the scientific... You could have journals that don't make profit.
Sure.
Right? And we have example here. And that in principle, there is no reason why there could not be an EMBL Nature having the same impact as Nature. There is nothing that Nature does in any special way.
Well, I mean, that's not entirely true, right? Because the you know, nature, the big problem with nature economically, right? And forget about all the problems there is with attaching too much significance to a single title, is that if you were to, you know, that most of the money that goes into nature goes to reject papers, right? They reject 95% or whatever more of the papers that get submitted to them. So most of the effort that's spent at the journal is spent on rejecting papers, right? So the problem with having an EMBL Nature is that you have, right, if that's what you do, you're spending a lot of effort to reject a lot of papers. So that's not the right model. But there is no reason why EMBL couldn't replace that niche by doing what I think they should do, which, and I think these guys are not, you know, are kind of thinking this way already, which is that EMBL changes its model from a model in which you accept or reject papers to a model in which they have some body of papers that they review, whether it's because they choose to review them or because the authors come to them and say, hey, we want you to review the paper. And they decide after reviewing it, they're not going to publish it because it's already published in BioArchive, right? They're just going to review it and decide how important and how interesting and to who it's important and judge it in that way, right? So that in some sense, there is an EMBL Nature, but it's not a distinct entity that accepts or rejects anything. It's a banner that papers get, or a badge, as I think people are thinking about them, that you get after peer review, where EMBL has said, this paper gets our, you know, triple gold star, or whatever their designation is. The right way to recreate the system is to have people be able to judge papers on their and rank them or score them however they see fit. I don't think we should have just one way of doing this. But crucially, two things are crucial about that. One is EMBL can do that. They can give it a gold star. They can retract the gold star if something changes in the paper, that it doesn't have to be permanent. And EMBL can review a paper, but so can somebody else. And that there's no reason to have this singular association with a paper and an outcome of review. And I think you keep all of the things we value in the current system and get rid of all, you know, at least many of the things that don't work by just shifting the focus of review. And note that in such a system, people are still doing basically the same thing. They're still reading papers and they're reviewing them, right? There's an editor who's trying to synthesize the output of that review. It's just they're no longer saying publish or not publish. They're all they're really doing is altering the output of the review process. Is that?
Yeah. I mean, it's my point was to distinguish between the issue of the financial and who makes money with the peer review problem. That to me might be even more complex because it's not clear that any of these solutions would be more effective.
So here, let me just say the important thing. Right now, those are coupled in a really bad way because the journals' peer review system is coupled into very much to the way they make money. right? And so they continue with a particular model of peer review, not because it's the right thing for the scientific community, but because it's the right thing for them to sell subscriptions to their journal. And I, you know, again, I don't know what the perfect way of reviewing. I think we have a lot of experimenting and trial and error and whatever to do. But I do know that right now, by coupling revenue for journals to essentially the way they do peer review, we've stifled innovation in peer review because journals only think about what's good for their subscriptions and not thinking about it in a broader service sense.
Right.
Call it a day?
Excellent.
Thank you.
This was inspiring. Wonderful. Thank you again, Michael. He's around. I don't know what Holder's plans are for him, but I'm sure acute questions.
Yeah, after.
Yes, good. Good.
Do you not back for the finals when it's Iceland, Belgium?
And we'll look at Iceland this evening. Okay, well, thank you everybody for the interesting questions, and thank you for
having me.